Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Mike Papantonio. Coming up on today's show, we'll find out why it's time to renew the war on poverty. We'll also debunk the oil industry's claim that peak oil is a liberal myth. And we'll tell you why Chris Christie's Al Capone-style politics has a recipe for disaster. We have all that and more, and remember, right now you just stepped into the Ring of Fire.
You can't change Washington from the inside. You can only change it from the outside.
Grand jury secrecy rules.
For political gain.
The press can find out.
That has nothing to do with politics, but go ahead.
It wouldn't bother me.
Oops.
It's been 50 years since the war on poverty began, and thanks to austerity policies, things are just as bad as ever. Joining me now to talk about the need for maybe a new war on poverty, a serious war on poverty, is Attorney Joe Cotchett. Joe, The Nation magazine did a great job trying to evaluate whether or not the war on poverty has been successful or whether it's had some failures. I remember the day, not necessarily the day, but I certainly remember the time when LBJ took to the podium and said, look, we have a war we have to win, and that war is on poverty. And I think back about what he was saying. I went back and actually took a look at the details of what he said. And if you take a look at those details, he was talking as much about the need to solve our economic problems by empowering people at the very last rung of our socioeconomic ladder. If you give them money, things are going to get better throughout the economy. It's going to make a more sustainable economy. What's your take on where we are and where we've come with the war on poverty?
Well, I think we have come a long way, but there's been some tremendous reversals since LBJ put those remarks before the American public. You remember that he was a teacher in South Texas, so he came out of that poverty zone.
Right.
And no other president, given the time period, could have got that war on poverty passed. He was a Southerner, and he brought along a lot of Southern votes. What's happened since then is that every president following him literally has now turned the view from the impoverished people to Wall Street, because now economics has taken a bigger role in our government and society and pushed aside many of those programs. It's being debated as we speak right now in Washington, D.C., as to whether or not we should extend benefits for 90 days for all those poor people that are out of work as a result of the conduct of Wall Street in 2007, 2008.
Well, if you look at what LBJ had to say, he said it's not just about empowering and educating and housing and clothing and giving people food. It's not just about that. He said we're the richest nation in the world, and right now all of our money is being held at the top. And there's no difference between what he said back there in 69 and what's actually going on today. If you hold all the money to the top, nothing trickles down. We know that the big lie that was given to us by Ronald Reagan was a horrendous lie. There was no truth to what he was saying. But LBJ had great economists around him. He had great economic people from every branch of education that said you have to empower the bottom to have a sustainable economy.
There's absolutely no question. And it's even, in my opinion, worse today in terms of the measurement about the size of the middle class. It is worse today because what we've allowed to happen is wealth to accumulate in that top 1-2% at a rate never seen before in history. For example, Mitt Romney finally admitted when he was running for president that he kept a family trust in the Cayman Islands. You have one of those, don't you? Oh, I have one, and everyone else on the street has a trust in the Cayman Islands. This is a man running for president. Can you imagine that?
And he felt, the thing is, Joe, he felt comfortable saying it. That's what's so remarkable about
it to me. Yes.
He said it during a time when 50 million Americans are living at poverty level in this country when we don't have a middle class. And let me shift to something on that,
sure.
A tad. We hear the president, we hear the Congress, we hear the Beltway talking about middle class. If you recall the way that talking point came, that we should just focus uniquely on the middle class, is because everything below the middle class wasn't empowered, you see. So we didn't worry about them. They were in
that. Well, they don't vote, remember.
They don't vote. They don't have lobbyists. They don't have any power. So the shift was, gee, we have to worry about the middle class. And even this president, Joe, if you listen very carefully, except for that speech that he gave in December where the Pope, I think, shamed him into talking about poverty.
Shamed him? Did you use the word shamed?
I used shamed, yes.
Yeah.
I think he shamed him into talking about poverty. But before then, the only discussion you'd hear out of the Beltway is, what about the middle class? It was that middle class dogma that seemed to appeal to everybody. What's your take on that?
Well, there's no question. You're right. And we forget about those people at the lower levels. And the reason we forget about them is because when I just interrupted you, it's because they don't vote. They have no voice. They have no gravitas. The middle class can have gravitas. And that's what the Beltway is concerned about, and that's why they're the target of the middle class. Now, when you say middle class, you understand that's got many, many different definitions. To Boehner, our speaker, the middle class is a Republican that lives in a very nice house outside of Cleveland and has a terrific job. That's not the middle class that other people
probably
speak
gated
about.
Gated community as well, right?
Thank you.
That's their notion of middle class. Well, okay,
we had this Borax
soap salesman from your state there in California show up on the political scene. General Electric had groomed him for no other purpose except to unleash him to make some cultural changes in this country. One cultural change was, we want to empower billionaires and millionaires, and we want to actually dilute the importance of the discussion that dealt with the idea that we need to take care of the least of our societies. Now, he launched that, and then all of a sudden we start hearing about the nanny state. We hear Paul Ryan talking about the nanny state, or Rush Limbaugh talking about the nanny state and the welfare queens. Now, that discussion has not gone away, Joe. As far as I see it, it's done is picked up momentum even as we speak. It's still out there, isn't it?
Oh, it's out there big time. Now, let me just contradict that or give you a different view. I think that they are learning, the Republicans now are learning, that they got to tone that rhetoric down for these next elections. But when you get inside that room, as some cameraman did or somebody who recorded that famous statement by Romney when he was running and he thought he was only talking around his friends, that 49% of the country is not to be worried about. They don't work, they don't count, et cetera, et cetera. Now, what I see coming now in the Republican rhetoric is that they have to look more towards the middle class. So I go back to my point. What is the definition of the middle class? We have major problems today when companies like General Electric pay no taxes. When you have a company like Apple that has $130 billion offshore, not adding to our economy. And that definition of middle class to the Republicans is, wow, that's terrific, that's great.
Mm. So what we've seen happening, if I were to say, are we in any worse shape than we were when LBJ in 64 said, look, he wasn't just talking about, I want to take care of poor people. If you listen very carefully and you take a look at what the discussion was, his discussion was, we have to put money into the system. We have to build infrastructures. We have to educate. We have to put money out there for the workers so they'll go buy things. And when they go buy things, we propel the economy from the bottom up. And then all of a sudden, the Borax salesman comes on. Ronald Reagan hadn't had an original thought that had been given to him since, God, I can't remember when. So this guy's on the scene and he starts telling us just the opposite of what we know works. And the American public buys into it. Why did the American public, Joe, as you analyze what happened here, why was the American public so willing to buy into that stupid talk?
Because media exploded. Just as social media is exploding today, they were able to communicate in a more financial or economic way. They put millions and millions of dollars into media. Remember when Fox News came on board? Remember when the Rush Limbaughs came on board with their talk radio shows? So there's been millions of dollars pushed into communicating with those people that have money that, look, get inside a gated community or you're going to lose everything you have.
And it gave these people, it honestly gave this middle class that's disappearing. Now, you may be a little more sympathetic about it than I am. When I think of this middle class that's so squarely bought into the idea that we have to support billionaires at the top of the heap because someday we're going to be a billionaire. We have to agree to go along with things that inheritance taxes are bad, or that corporations shouldn't pay any taxes, or that offshore banking is just fine. You had middle class, Joe, actually buying into that. At some point, you had union workers buying into that because they believed this lie. It was almost it was this huge lie that if you'll go along with us on this, someday you're going to be that billionaire and you're going to benefit. What's your quick take on that?
Sure. I don't think they thought they were going to become billionaires. What they were given was promises that could not be met today. You want to talk about public pensions just as an example? I mean, here in California, we have cities and counties that are almost bankrupt because we started pushing, if you will, at that select few of middle class monies that we just didn't have. Look, here's the bottom line. The bottom line is today we have to take a look at this war on poverty again and really make it work, make it effective. This is a class warfare today in Washington, D.C. That's why you have this stridency. That's why they can't talk to each other. We have some great people in Washington that are concerned about our poor people, that are concerned about poverty, the 50 million you mentioned on food stamps. And it is a battle, and the key to that battle, Mike, is getting people registered to vote. That's the key. If you can go into the poor neighborhoods and get them registered to vote, watch how quickly things will change.
Let's hope, Joe. Joe Cotchett, thank you for joining me as usual. Interesting take on the war on poverty. Thank you for joining me.
Thanks, Mike.
The oil industry wants us to believe that North America is sitting on an endless supply of natural gas and oil, and they want to access every bit of it, no matter how much damage it does. The truth is, there's barely enough fossil fuel in the ground to sustain the United States for very long. I have Michael Klare with me to tell us why peak oil is still a very real threat. Michael is the author of the new book, The Race for What's Left. Michael, peak oil, we used to hear, gee whiz, peak oil is here, we're in big trouble, and we're going to run out of oil. And then all of a sudden you had this, I'll call it a lull. It was that people stopped talking about this notion of peak oil that's been out there for quite some time, where M. King Hubert used to talk about the notion that we may be running out of oil. Give me your take on the peak oil issue as it sits today.
Well, it's not just that people stopped talking about peak oil. You actually had a counteroffensive, people saying peak oil is dead, peak oil is dead. People saying that because of the new technologies like hydrofracking and the development of shale oil and tar sands and the rest, we have an unlimited supply of oil. So the whole notion of peak oil is dead and we should stop talking about it. And that was the discourse for the past year or so.
Well, part of that discourse, if you really look behind the story, some of the people had a direct interest in trying to shut that argument of peak oil down because you had people saying, okay, if we're running out of oil, let's look at alternative energy. Let's look at geothermal and wind and various types of energy that we can tap into. And so what that did was discourage that effort, didn't it?
Exactly right. Yes. I think there are many people who have a vested interest in shutting down peak oil theory. As you say, if you take peak oil seriously, then you have to have a crash effort to develop energy alternatives, especially renewables. But if you say peak oil is dead, then let's go ahead. Let's go full steam ahead and develop the fossil fuel alternatives to the limit, sands and everything else.
Let's keep on the same course we are now. Hell with the issue of global climate change. hell with the issue that we know we can do better. Let's simply stick with what we have. Part of that, Michael, wasn't it driven by the idea that with things like fracking and extraction from shore, from sands, wasn't part of it that you now have investors that were willing to put more money into that because they're willing to say, look, this might be a good moneymaker, even though it's more difficult to extract the oil. We as investors are going to stand behind it. Tell me about the investor impact of all of this.
I think the investor impact is huge. I think that investors, hedge funds, banks, private individuals saw that this was going to be a monumental moneymaker for them because, let's face it, the demand for oil is not going away. And if you could suddenly produce a lot of new oil supplies by using these technologies, and you have it right here in North America, they're saying to themselves, wow, we could make a lot of money this way. And who cares about global warming? Future generations will have to deal with that. I mean, I think that's the attitude that they're taking.
In other words, just hell with everybody else. We want to increase our market share. We want to make more money. Hell with your grandchildren and their great-grandchildren. It doesn't matter to us. We're going to put in place something called techno-dynamism. I mean, that's kind of the idea, isn't it? This idea, we have new technology. Let's use that new technology, even though we know, A, we're destroying the planet. B, it's preventing us from moving into alternative sources that we ought to be paying attention to. And C, we're not going to be around. Our grandchildren and their children are going to have to worry about this.
Yes, and sad to say, it's not just investors and bankers who are saying this. It's also a lot of politicians. Even President Obama has embraced this point of view because a lot of these new fossil fuel supplies are, as I say, they're coming from the United States, and where people are saying, well, all of a sudden, we have a huge supply of energy right here in our backyard. It frees us from dependence on those nasty Arabs in the Middle East. We have new energy independence. This is great. Let's go full steam. Not only that, it's producing a new industrial revolution in the United States. All this additional energy is inviting corporations to move here. So all of this has pushed the climate issue totally to the side.
Well, you keep hearing these assertions that the United States is going to overtake Saudi Arabia as the big oil producers, and that at point, I think the number that you talked about is 2030, that America was going to become a net oil exporter. Do we really care about that? If we really weigh that against the idea that we're destroying our environment, I mean, just look at what BP did to the Gulf Coast here. We're still in horrible situation because of that. Yes, they can go find the oil in 5 miles deep, but can they get it out safely? And the industry admits, I mean, we've taken the depositions, Michael. The depositions, they basically admit, no, this is a huge risk. And they say that, and they say, no, we don't really have the technology to handle this problem if something goes wrong. This is what they're saying in the depositions that are being taken on the BP case.
Well, to be perfectly honest, I wrote a book called Blood and Oil, in which I
read it. It's very good, by the way.
I decried the dependence that the U.S. had on Middle Eastern oil because it led us to fight wars over there. And so I saw an advantage in reducing our dependence on Middle Eastern oil, thinking maybe prematurely, that we wouldn't fight as many wars. But now we've gone in the other direction. Now we're saying, let's tear apart our country. Let us destroy the countryside. Let's frack the hell out of the United States. And as you say, drill in our coastal waters without any care for the environment. So we're going completely, on one hand, we sacrificed our security by going to war. Now we're sacrificing our well-being by tearing up the countryside.
Michael, also in your book, Blood and Oil, that's a book, by the way, they can get on our website, Ring of Fire Radio website. It's order right through Amazon. It's such a great book. But it tells the story. And as I remember the discussion in that book, I think what scares me the most is we used to regard other parts of the world is the place we could go and pollute. We could extract resources. We could take advantage of everything that they had. We could destroy their environment and then leave. Now, what has happened is, as you point out, we've now become that third world country where you have international conglomerates coming into the United States, treating us like we as the U.S. used to treat South Africa or South America. We're now the victim here. We're the person that is that where our resources are being extracted, our environment's being destroyed. We're left with all these external problems that the industry's left with us. Talk to me about that. And see. And first of all, did I get it right? And do you see that changing any time in the future with this administration?
Yes, I think you got it right. And I think this is a very interesting. We're coming up soon in another few years to the 50th anniversary of Earth Day. And Earth Day, as you'll recall, was prompted by the great Santa Barbara oil spill of 1969, which set the environmental movement in motion. And out of that came a lot of environmental laws saying you can't engage in polluting activities, you can't drill offshore, you can't do a lot of that. And it forced the oil companies to drill in what we used to call the third world, as you say, Latin America and Africa. But now countries in the third world aren't, you know, as we might say, the third world anymore. They're imposing their own environmental regulations. They're nationalizing oil companies. So American companies are coming back here.
Yeah, in other words, you have state-owned companies, as you're pointing out. I mean, government-owned companies that are some of the largest oil fields in the world, as you're pointing out. We used to go there, and we used to extract oil and leave a mess and then come home. Now they're saying, no, you can't do that. So you have the big oil companies saying, well, hell with that. We're going to do exactly what BP or Exxon it does to the United States, and that is destroy the environment, make $40 to $50 billion a year, pay a fine if we have to, and go on about life like nothing has happened. These fines don't mean anything to these corporations, do they?
No, you're absolutely right. And not only are they coming here and engaging in all kinds of environmental hazards, but they're running roughshod over state legislators, over local communities. They're pushing aside all kinds of environmental protections that have been in place for 50 years in order to be able to engage in these hazardous operations.
Michael, I talk about the idea that NAFTA, they're already using NAFTA. You have international conglomerates using NAFTA to go to places like Canada and say, you know what, don't tell us we can't frack. Don't tell us that we can't drill in an area you don't want us to drill, because to do that, you're going to violate treaties and we're going to sue you. They've already done that in Canada. Chances are we're going to see a lot more of that in the United States with TPP if it actually takes off, won't it?
Absolutely. But the big target right now is Mexico. There's unbelievable pressure being brought on Mexico to revise their constitution. If there's anything more sacred in Mexico, it's that oil should be the province of the state and the national government alone. And enormous pressure is being brought by the oil companies to revise the constitution to allow them to come in and develop Mexico's oil shale and shale gas, which is believed to be almost as great as America's.
Yeah.
This is happening right now.
Golden rule, everybody with the gold makes all the rules and tramples on everybody else if they so choose. That's what we see BP doing down on the coast every single day. Michael Klare, thank you for joining me, okay?
It's always a pleasure.
Companies across America are taking a page out of the payday loan scam playbook, and they're now trying to trap their own employees with the use of company loans. Joining me now to explain how that works is Howard Nations. Howard, times are tough out there, and because of that, we always see the predators come out when times are tough. What is your observation about what you're seeing about this new economy that, you know, you hear jobs are great and everybody's fine, but you drill right down, it's not exactly the case, is it?
Well, actually, Mike, the gap between the rich and poor is widening in this country. almost exponentially. The rich are getting richer, but the poor are also getting poorer. And one reason is because many of the rich are stealing from the poor through predatory lending. The fact is that if you define paycheck to paycheck, which economists do, as not having enough savings to survive for 6 months, 76% of Americans are living paycheck to paycheck. 40% have less than $500 in savings, which means that they're one car repair or one child illness away from being a target for predatory lenders. They can't get the usual bank loans. They're a poor credit risk, and the payday lenders have had a field day with them with their 500% interest, making 15-day loans at 15% for 15 days. At their peak, the predatory payday lenders had more outlets than McDonald's and Burger King combined.
Howard, wasn't there a day where government paid attention to that? Where we had, I realize right now, I know you saw this story, but there are more millionaires in Congress in the D.C. Beltway than there have ever been. And so I'm not suggesting that they give a damn or that they're paying much attention to what's going out there in real America outside the Beltway. But there used to be things in place that would prevent the type of predatory conduct that you're talking about.
Well, the Congress today responds to their corporate masters. To a large extent, many congressmen are legislative lapdogs for corporate America. And the people who are the subject of these predatory loans are the very least of their worries. These people are being, the American public, are being trapped into financial servitude by predatory lenders who have their usurious interest rates and their hidden fees. For example, one of the things that's happened in recent years, you've seen the very ease of credit card access, car loans extending 5 to 6 year payouts, subprime mortgages loaned with the intent to foreclose. And we had the payday lenders, and the people who did crack down on them were not the Congress. The people who cracked down on them were the states. The Justice Department began investigating, and finally, now that we finally got approval of the head of the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, in November, they sued Cash America International, Inc., who is a major predatory lender, for scamming 14,000 people with a robo-signing debt collection scam. And they were awarded $14 million to cover those 14,000 people, plus a $5 million loan.
Explain that scam. I mean, that's an ugly little story, isn't it?
It's an ugly story. But here's the problem with that story and many others, Mike. They steal millions and millions and millions. And in the case of the banks, billions and billions. But then when they get fined, they pay a $5 million fine. When they get caught, they got 14,000 people who are awarded $14 million. Sounds like a lot of money until you stop and figure out that's only $1,000 each. And a lot of them are being scammed for a lot more than that. So one of the major problems now is that the cost of scamming, the cost of predatory lending, the cost of banks just stealing us blind, is that they then have to pay a very small percentage of what they steal back to the federal government in terms of a fine, and then they go right on about their business.
And taxpayers, the startling story that's emerging more and more is that taxpayers are actually paying for that because that predatory company is taking it as a tax write-off.
Absolutely.
Let me shift here just a second. The workplace loan.
Yes.
Where I was growing, I grew up in the South, and
yep.
I've worked picking oranges and watermelons, and about everything I've done it. But you would see migrant workers come in to work those fields, and there would be what they call a store loan. It would be a workplace loan. It went as a way to scam people. Explain that story a little bit, because there's a resurgence of that.
Well, actually, I grew up in the South also, and I saw the same thing. And we actually lived in a home that was owned by the company, and that's what they did. The company store owned the homes. They owned they provided the food. They provided the necessities. They leased the equipment that the people worked with, and then they deducted it from their paycheck. They even got to the point before labor unions, in the coal mines particularly, where they would pay their workers with scrip, which could only be used to pay off their debt. Now, the new form of that is called a service. They can't call it a loan anymore because they'll be subject to usurious charges. So today, the unscrupulous employers are combining with predatory lenders where the employee advance is made in his paycheck. The employee receives the loan of $500 or whatever the amount in their paycheck. They pay interest rates of up to 165% per annum, but then the predatory lender is repaid from the paycheck. Right now, there are six companies and about 100,000 employees that are being scammed in this manner.
So what ends up happening, if you really drill down here, Howard, is you have the employer who's making more money by doing this, by cutting some sweetheart deal with some scamming third party that says, I saw this story out of Arizona restaurant system, Scottsdale, Arizona. Company operates 28 Sonic locations in the state, and they allow their workers to take out these loans from $150 to $500 that last about 2 weeks. And then when they have to start paying them back, there's not only a fee to get the loan of about $25, but there's this ridiculous interest that kicks in. But that is a product, isn't it, Howard, of the employer actually working in cahoots with some third party?
Absolutely. And the effective interest rate on that is 100% to 165%. And the employer says, yes, but this is so much better than the payday loans, which is like saying, yes, but Stalin was so much better than Hitler.
as you look at this story, the ugly thing is, when you follow the money, now some of these stories, the banking, the people that are fronting the money are even international corporations. I mean, they're not even American corporations. But a lot of them are just Wall Street corporations where they've shuffled around, moved a few shells to where you can't tell who they are. But if you follow the money, it goes all the way back to Wall Street. The effort to cover this up is pretty substantial, isn't it?
It is. And there has been one cautionary tale in that Inc. magazine recently warned employers that these loans that they're making now may expose them to complicity result in discrimination suits against them. So even the corporate America's Bible is getting concerned about this.
Now, there's some solutions, if you were to say, what is the best solution, where does it begin besides chopping off the head of the snake? What do you do?
Well, there are a couple of things. One is that let's don't overlook the fact that there are some good employer loans. These are not all bad. There's an organization called Emerge Workplace Solutions, which is a social mission-driven business which partners with banks and credit unions to offer short-term loans up to $2,500 at 9 to 18% interest with no hidden fees. They provide financial counseling, they help build credit scores, they train their employees to avoid debt, and they stabilize finances.
But now, that's a situation where the employer is really trying to say to the employee, let me make your life better. Right. I want your life to be better because you become a better employee when your life is better. You're not worried about, can you pay for food? Can you pay for clothing and housing? Let me help you do that, which seems to be really a great thing for employers to be thinking about.
Right.
So this is the company's called Emerge Workplace Solutions.
Right. Now, the solutions that need to come from the government, and good luck with that. But the first of all, the people can try to avoid short-term high-interest loans to cover wage shortfalls. But what the government needs to do is to raise the minimum wage to a living wage level to avoid constant shortage of money. But as long as Congress and the politicians continue to use the poor as a political football to please their corporate masters in matters such as long-term employment benefits, our minimum wage, which gets kicked around back and forth with no real thought to the people that it's affecting. And until they start implementing full employment policies, this is going to continue. They could follow the guidelines of FDR, who hired the unemployed to maintain the infrastructure of this country, which is in horrible shape right now. They were hired to do child care for people who were employed. They were hired as teachers. And one other thing they can do is they can begin imprisoning
the criminals,
the bankers, and the predatory lenders, put them in prison and let them serve some time instead of simply fining them by taking a small portion of their ill-gotten gains. It's never going to stop.
We, we perpetuate a culture of crime all the way from Wall Street right down to the Main Street in our hometowns, because that culture of crime seems to flourish on the idea that we don't have law enforcement that is willing to lock up white-collar criminals. Howard Nations, thank you for joining me, okay? As usual, it's a great report. It's something most people don't know about.
My pleasure, Mike. Thanks.
So, Pap, of course, the big story this week was the revelations of the culpability of members of Chris Christie's administration, at the least, in the political vendetta where they shut down traffic lanes leading from Fort Lee, New Jersey, onto the busiest bridge in the world, the George Washington Bridge, causing all sorts of traffic snarls and delays for emergency workers and students going to school for the first day. And this is the moment where I think Chris Christie's political fortunes go away.
Well, I mean, the question that is, I don't think, is being asked enough. Let's assume that this, first of all, he's a guy who surrounded himself with petty little numbskulls, okay? This is like, this is not like a fraternity trick. This is something that put human life at risk. It prevented children from being able to make it to school, for God's sakes. And then he comes out, his staff comes out and say, well, basically they deserve it because they're Democrats. Okay, now let's take him 4 years from now. He's sitting in the White House, and here's what we need to understand. A staff follows a guy like that. He doesn't go out and say, look, I'm going to just get a bunch of whole new people. You know, this is the Rahm Emanuel story, where Rahm Emanuel type guy followed Obama. Well, he has people following the same way. The staff he surrounds himself with at that point, though, is, hey, why don't we mess with China? Okay, why don't we mess with Russia? You know, let's play a few tricks on them and see how that goes. His lack of judgment from the very beginning, Sam, of people who he surrounded himself with. Look, these people have been with him his entire career.
Right.
And you don't say, hey, I don't think you're going to work out here, man. You're nuts.
Now, Pap, it's a little bit early to perhaps to say this, but frankly, I think this goes way beyond lack of judgment. I mean, let's just back up for one minute.
That's the best story.
That is the best case scenario that you could say in this situation. But let's go back a little bit and just catch people up if they aren't fully aware of this story. Back in September, a guy named David Wildstein, who was a longtime childhood friend of Chris Christie, he had been appointed when Christie was elected to a position that did not exist prior to his appointment. An invented position that paid a six-figure salary at the Port Authority. And there had been some talk about how randomly these lanes were cut down in Fort Lee. Fort Lee had a Democratic mayor who refused to endorse Chris Christie. The mayor had been convinced that this was some type of political retribution. There was under oath testimony given by Christie officials that this was not about retribution. It was about a traffic study. Subsequently, it came out that no one in the Port Authority was aware of any traffic study, that the
the man in charge, the very person who would be in charge of that kind of traffic study, said nobody
right.
ever
the whole agency him. Denied the existence the of a traffic
director.
Study. And so what you saw then was two guys who had to give their resignation: David Wildstein, a longtime Christie friend, another a former state senator Baroni, who was a Port Authority official,
who
at
is
that
a
time.
True thug. Do some short searching on the, he's a thug. Okay.
And so that's where it laid until earlier this week on Wednesday morning when there are differing stories about this, but from what the Times account and the Bergen Record, which is a local New Jersey paper, which they say there were subpoenaed documents which showed text exchanges and email exchanges between Wildstein and Baroni and between Wildstein and the deputy chief of staff to Chris Christie, a woman named Kelly. Now, these documents were also redacted at some very key points. According to the New York Times, these were redacted by Wildstein.
More than a quarter of the document was redacted. It's just, in other words, what you get is a document with a bunch of black, big old black lines through it, the most important things that you want. You know,
and this is something that we need to talk about, and I want to get your perspective on this, Pap, because you're obviously an expert. Now, if you read these documents, you see Wildstein is implicated in shutting this down, A, B, shutting it down just to cause traffic. In fact, Kelly texted Wildstein and said, it's time for some traffic in Fort Lee. 2 weeks later, they implement this plan, like we said, on the first day of school. It causes all sorts of problems. There are 4 documented cases where emergency responders couldn't get to people.
One man
in one case,
died.
A 91 old woman died.
Yeah, old
and
man died.
This goes back and forth. So Wildstein, who supposedly redacted these things, is implicated in these documents. But there's one exchange, and this is what I want you to expect.
Yeah.
There's one exchange where he redacts in a conversation where person A, unidentified because it's redacted, says to Wildstein on a text, I feel sort of bad for these kids, I guess. Wildstein responds, hey, they're Cuomo voters, Buono voters. Speaking of who Christie's opponent was.
Yeah, and they're Democrats.
Right.
Okay, so here's where this goes. He redacted it for a reason. Obviously, he's worried that might be a person that comes forward and speaks. Every time you see that. You know, a redaction, there's a whole discipline of what to read into a redaction and when you're looking at documents. I mean, this is what I do. We do it every day, all the time. But when you start seeing names taken out, and not everybody's name, but just a particular name taken out, what they've analyzed is this is a person who will cave in. Okay, this is somebody who's going to, you know, we better cover them up as much as we can because they're going to cave in. That's the first thing. The second thing is they're going to get these entire documents because this is not just a little comical event. This is a criminal event. And at this point, you have Wildstein. This guy's already probably committed perjury every other kind of way. I mean, by the way, I'm sure there was some level of investigation to a government authority. That's, you know, he's probably already committed perjury. But, you know, here's the, Sam, listen. These are people that he's with every day.
Yes.
That Christie's with every day. That's the first thing. The second thing is, if you believe for a second that life doesn't exist in a vacuum. You don't walk into an office of people that you work with every day and there's no discussion at all with Chris Christie about what occurred. And then Chris Christie, you know, for him to say, oh, gee, I didn't know it, that is not going to hold up.
And frankly, I'm not convinced that these aren't going to lead him to leave office early as a governor of New Jersey. Just to recap, he had a press conference this week where he basically said, I was duped. I had no idea about this. Mm. Oddly, he said, I had 2 nights of sleepless nights when I heard about this.
His best
Yet,
friend.
He was 24 hours away from when he had supposedly found out about it.
Exactly.
And then we know that the guy he was talking about pled the fifth and it was held in
childhood
contempt.
Friend.
Yes.
This thing about the fifth, that's, you know what, it does, at this point, what you have is a criminal event. This is not, you know, slapstick comedy. This is not some damn idiot fraternity gig going on here. This is a criminal event. A person died. Somebody's going to be sued. You know, he has this crew of people that allow this to go on. Now, the truth is, it's going to come by way of a lawsuit. Let's go the easiest route. A civil lawsuit is going to, these documents are going to be uncovered there. But they're probably going to be uncovered before then because there are criminal ramifications to what has happened here. You see, this whole chain of events carries with it criminal ramifications. Now, the other part of it, at this point, big boy, has not, you know, he hasn't committed perjury, I don't think. I don't know. I don't know what investigators have talked to him. But he certainly lied to everybody around him. to believe that he didn't know this is you'd have to be a fool.
Now, Pap, there's two instances where he's claiming he didn't know. He claims that he didn't have any prior knowledge to what was taking place. In fact, he was still claiming this week that it could have been a traffic test. But what is really unbelievable is that two guys resigned from his administration because of this scandal. And in the subsequent, 100 days that took place, that he didn't know any of this. This is just beyond belief. Now, Sam, let me ask you this. What is the relevance? If it was Wildstein who actually redacted and released these documents that he knew had been subpoenaed by this panel that he was going to take the oath for, why would he put that out the night before? In other words, why was there 24 hours where the...
Because they're talking. Look, Sam. You're working in an office. You've been elected governor. You hire your best. Think of who your best friend is. Guy's been with you your entire life, okay? Your best friend has done something, and you know he's done it. You might have even, you know, gotten a chuckle, yucca, yucca, ya-ya over it. I don't know. This may be a big funny thing that was going on. But you don't, to suggest that there's no conversation with your lifelong best friend and say, the first time I learned this is now? Oh, come on. I mean, really?
Now let me ask you this. Now, if, you know, getting back to what Wildstein chose to redact, the timing is one thing because it gives 24 hours. I mean, it's almost as if he was sending a message to the Christie administration. This is what they have. This is what I know about. I'm going to protect this person, whoever that person is.
Because that person might talk. I've talked to that person, and I'm afraid that that person's going to cave in, but go ahead.
Or could that person have been someone who is actually higher placed than the deputy chief of staff?
Could be, but it's more likely. I mean, if I were just analyzing the what we see typically is that you usually cover that up when somebody is really freaked out.
So the weakest link is covered up and given the protection so that that person doesn't unwind the whole thing.
Yeah, it's either that or it's somebody at the very top of the food chain, one or the other.
And so the question becomes then, what is David Wildstein willing to do? Because there's now a federal investigation. We still see the state investigation going forward. There could very well be a Senate investigation because, of course, we're talking about interstate transportation issues here. Because that bridge spans two states.
Wildstein's going to start singing like a bird, man. And then this other person that person's probably already talking. You know, the person that was blacked out of that thing is either already talking to the feds or somebody, or they're so high up in the ranks that they can't say a word. But it's more likely that it's just some numbnut way down on the list that he's talking to. But, you know, the point is this. This is not the first rodeo for Chris Christie.
Oh, I mean,
you know the story. We've done these stories time and time again. You want to do a recap? What is it?
Well, I mean, we don't have time to do all that here, but I'll tell you what is clear, though, is that there's more stuff to come out, and this is something that's going to dog him for months. Maybe on the civil side, they are hoping that these cases can be tied up long enough to get past the 2016.
Oh, my God. But, this is a wonderful civil case.
And so let me ask you this. I mean, what do you think? I never thought much of Christie's chances in 2016 anyways,
but this seems to
go straight to the heart of his one constituency, the corporate media who love him.
Well, at this point, all this says to him is, look, why do I want to do this to myself? This is going to be a very personal decision. He's not going to be run out of this, so to speak, strong-armed out of it. It's simply going to be the thing that says, this is that one thing that's going to change my mind.
Well, I imagine we're going to be talking about this more as the revelations continue. Pap, as always, great talking to you.
Thanks, Sam.
The Pap Attack.
Lyndon Baines Johnson understood that his war on poverty was certainly designed as a way for Americans to responsibly move into a part of their life where they could live with a little bit of dignity. But LBJ was also responding to the advice of talented economists, talented sociologists, who educated LBJ on the idea that the way to build a sustainable, strong economy is to begin at the bottom and then grow upward. In other words, LBJ understood that when Americans living on the margins, where that individual is struggling to provide for food and shelter for their family, a place to live for their family, just when they're just trying to get by, if you give them something, they put it back into the economy. Now, LBJ and his advisors understood that the war on poverty was also, in effect, a war to increase prosperity in this country. But then when the crazy train hit Washington, D.C., mostly during the Reagan years, intellectually dishonest conservatives, think tanks, and opportunists, they came and they told the American public that they had a new invention. They told America that their new invention was going to turn old, worn-out notions of economics on its head, and that we're even going to see greater prosperity because of their new invention. That big invention, that big lie, was called trickle-down economics. Small groups of billionaire inheritance babies who had never gone hungry a day in their lives convinced the American media to sell the American public on the idea that if we could simply give insanely wealthy individuals, wealthy corporations more money, that if we could give more money to that Grey Poupon billionaire crowd, that they were going to share their windfalls with America's working poor, and it's going to lessen the burden for taxpayers. That was the big pitch. Now, the truth is that the American media figured out that that was a lie, that it was a trickle-down fraud. They knew that 5 years into the program. Honest writers had been writing about what a lie it was 5 years into the program. But by the time the billionaire scam was in place, you had billionaires buying up the media. So the trickle-down trash argument, it could be recycled day after day in TV and radio and in print. As a matter of fact, this week we're seeing this irresponsible corporate media pitching the teabag Republican talking point that if we don't do something to take money away from workers, that it's going to hurt the worker. That's their pitch. Listen carefully to what they're going to say. They're going to say that unemployed workers would actually benefit if we take this safety net away from them. According to the outlets like CNBC and Fox, American workers have become too lazy. They become too comfortable with the table scraps that billionaires are throwing on the floor for them. And the trickle-down idea is that if we give working poor no table scraps at all, then the economy is going to spin into a new level of prosperity because those millions of what they call lazy workers who can't provide for food or clothing for their family or housing for their children, that they're going to miraculously invent some new way to generate money, and that's going to generate an increase of prosperity in our economy. That is really their argument. Listen to the argument coming from the Hill and coming from the store-bought corporate media. You've got if you listen to McConnell, you listen to Boehner, you listen to those types, you're going to conclude that they believe that when a person is starving, that that person is somehow going to reach further down and find some character and some resource that allows them to live and launch themselves out of poverty. Since the days that that feeble, old, tired, old man, Ronald Reagan, sold his trickle-down revolution, the Republican Party and all the oddballs who still call themselves Republicans have taken on the appearance of characters that are void of decency. They're predators willing to evaluate right and wrong uniquely in terms of a dollar. They've so completely lost their moral compass, in fact, that this week the House Republican Conference had to send out a memo telling them how to act like they had empathy. The memo instructed them how you can at least fool the American public to make them believe that you have a sense of compassion. The memo really did go out. Millions of unemployed people today are going to be told by the Republican by the Republican congressman that, gee, the reason they voted against extending benefits was because they were trying to help them. They have compassion. The truth is we have a better chance of gasoline dropping to $1 a gallon than we do having a 2014 Republican even spelling empathy correctly or even spelling compassion correctly, much less understanding it. You know, I'd advise the House Republican Conference fool who sent out that ridiculous memo that they can't reinvent reality. The very reason that the people they're communicating with are Republicans in 2014 is because they have zero kinship with the average American worker. They don't understand what it's like when a person can't feed their children or have a place to live or clothe their children. For years, the Republican advisors like Frank Luntz have been trying to coach people to tell them how to act. People like Mitch McConnell and Marco Rubio. Coach them into at least giving the appearance of being a well-adjusted human being. In the same way that the stripes will always distinguish the difference between a damn zebra and an extraordinary-looking stallion, the GOP in front of a politician's name is always going to separate that politician from the overwhelming majority of Americans who genuinely believe that empathy plays a part in the way we treat our fellow man, that compassion really does matter in the way that we treat our neighbor that can't afford food for his family. People like McConnell and people like Boehner, I have to tell you, if you're listening, you're always going to be a damn zebra. You'll never be a stallion. That's it for this week's Ring of Fire, but you can keep up with us throughout the week online at ringoffireradio.com or on Twitter at Ring of Fire Radio and on Facebook. I'm Mike Papantonio, and we'll see you next week right here on Ring of Fire.